This podcast is brought to you by WRFL, Radio Free Lexington. Find us online at WRFL.fm. Catch us on your FM radio while you're in Central Kentucky at 88.1 FM all the way to the left. Thank you for listening, and please be sure to subscribe.
Welcome to Philosophy Bakes Bread, food for thought about life and leadership.
Philosophy Bakes Bread is a production of the Society of Philosophers in America, a.k.a. SOPHIA. I'm Dr. Eric Thomas Weber.
And I'm Dr. Anthony Cashio. A famous phrase says that philosophy bakes no bread that is not practical, but we in SOPHIA and on this show aim to correct that misperception.
Philosophy Bakes Bread airs on WRFL Lexington 88.1 FM and is distributed as a podcast next. Listeners can find us online at philosophybakesbread.com, and we hope you'll reach out to us on Twitter at philosophybb, on Facebook at philosophybakesbread, or by email at philosophybakesbread@gmail.com.
Last but not least, you can leave us a short recorded message with a question or a comment or even some bountiful, bouncy praise. We always like that. You can reach us at 859-257-1849. That's 859-257-1849. We're super excited about today's conversation. We're going to be talking with Jack Symes about evil suffering, God, and ethics with Jack Symes. So welcome, Jack.
Hello, thank you for having me on. It's very exciting. I'm looking forward to baking some bread, presuming this is the cooking show that I thought it was.
Exactly right.
It's going to be delicious. So we're going to be exploring questions that relate to how the existence of evil relates to nature and the nature of God. Mm.
Jack graduated from the University of Liverpool in philosophy and went on to a postgraduate in teaching studies at the University of Birmingham. Jack is currently teaching philosophy at King Edward VI High School for Girls.
Jack is also the host of the weekly Panscycast Philosophy Podcast. The Panscycast describes itself as, I'm going to go ahead and read this here and get it all right, informal and informative philosophy podcast that supports teachers, students, and academics in philosophy, which also aims to awaken fellow freethinkers worldwide and inspire a new generation of philosophers. With over 70,000 subscribers, I'd say you're accomplishing your goal, Jack. Very well done. It's an awesome podcast.
Thank you. I appreciate it. You guys do a very similar job and a brilliant job as well, I might add, over Philosophy Bakes Bread, I think. I should say that the jingle, the WRFL jingle at the start, it's incredible. It's bouncy. I want to give it bountiful praise. But your guitar jingle as well, very similar to ours. Not saying, I think you were before us, your podcast, the Philosophy Bakes Bread started. Very similar, not just in our music, but I guess in our mission as well. So
well, I appreciate it. We were delighted to have you on. We talk sometimes about cross-pollinating audiences, you know, in podcasting, and I think it's a good idea. Well, Jack, we start each episode, as you know, respecting the call to know thyself.
Given that,
we'd love to hear about your background and how it shaped who you are as a person. Then let us know about how that brought you to your interests in studying philosophy and what that means to you. Tell us about yourself, Jack. Do you know thyself? And who is Jack Symes?
Who are you, Jack?
That's such a difficult question. I mean, on our podcast, we spoke to Galen Strawson in one of our recent interviews. He's big on philosophy of mind. And he was talking to us about how he perceives himself. And I guess I've got some similar views to him in that I don't really see myself as the same person as I was like a week ago, let alone, I guess, 25 years ago, which is my ripe young age. But I'll try and, I guess, I'd give a narrative on.
So that's a very convenient point of view when you owe people money, right?
Yeah, it's a convenient point of view when you
hear
this
story. That wasn't me, that was the other Jack.
I don't owe anybody money, and my lawyer can attest to that. So, I guess let's throw right back. I was speaking to my parents in anticipation because I knew you'd do this know thyself. And the picture that I use on most social media is this old picture of me as a young boy, but I must have been a toddler maybe, or in between the ages of 6 and 12. And I guess I was just, my parents described me as a cheeky, curly-haired boy who just wanted to make people laugh. And that's kind of what my memories are of being a kid. I remember just doing stand-up anywhere that I could. I just wrote my jokes down on little pieces of paper, and whether it was parties or like little talent shows. I remember my grandparents' house, just I had loads of these jester hats, with the proper traditional jester hats with bells and everything.
With the even jingling while you walk around?
Yeah, I just wanted to be a jester. Like literally, I loved making people laugh.
If you've got a picture of that, that should totally be the image of our episode, by the way.
I'll have to get in touch with my parents and see if
I'm not sure that suits the God and suffering, actually, now that I think about it.
It might be a bit distasteful. let's fast forward, I guess, to what you guys call high school.
So are you still cheeky and curly haired in high school?
No, I was still cheeky. I just lost the curly hair, and I had a series of very bad hairstyles. And
you
perhaps
have to try them out, right?
Yeah. Well, I guess you don't want to see any photos of them. They will not be shared for any amount. And I guess, yeah, I still wanted to make people laugh, and I was just so indifferent to everything I was studying. Like, I couldn't care less about anything I was learning about in school, and I was equally indifferent to my grades. And yeah, I was just really disinterested. But at the same time, I was troubled by philosophical questions, as most young people are, especially to those like pertaining to existentialism, philosophy of religion. And yeah, it wasn't until my late teens, around, well, the age of 16, in the United Kingdom, in England, you can choose to drop down to four subjects in post-16 education. So one of those I took was philosophy of religion and moral philosophy class. And yeah, I just instantly fell in love with it. I couldn't believe that there was actually a subject dedicated to learning and thinking about these questions. And I was completely obsessed from day one, and I turned all my grades around. All I wanted to do was study this for the rest of my life, and so far, so good.
It's a pretty good gig if you can get it.
Yeah.
Did you find that basically, you know, part of what's attractive for some people in philosophy is that you get to sort of question and challenge those things where everyone used to make you kind of just accept something, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. You know, philosophy encourages you to challenge the fundamental questions, right?
Mm, yeah, and certainly. And it wasn't the philosophers of religion or the moral philosophers necessarily that made me challenge things. I was kind of aware of some of the ideas we were looking at. Cosmological argument, obviously, being the first cause, the universe must have a first cause. This was fascinating, but not something I hadn't thought about before. It was people outside of what my classes were, people like Heraclitus, an ancient pre-Socratic, like before Socrates philosopher, and Parmenides as well, and how they viewed the universe. So these theories that the universe might just be this big block where the past, present, and future all exist as one, but as these temporal in time beings, as these beings which are chained to the world and space and time, we can't see the future, but everything's actually unchanging. And this was fascinating for me, like thinking about questions of space and time were perhaps where my first love of it came. And yeah, I wasn't a very good philosopher. In many ways, I'm still not good, but people like to say Aristotle was wrong about most things, but you're certainly right that it takes a lot of practice to be a good philosopher. Hmm. I'm still getting there, as I think all philosophers rightly are. And I really disliked at the time the idea that philosophy of religion was philosophy. I think there's a stereotype in the United Kingdom, especially because philosophy is lumped together with religious studies taught in schools. And I really disliked this idea. I thought I knew all the joys that philosophy had, and I wanted it to branch apart from religious studies because people didn't really care about religious studies where I was at school. So for a while, I rejected that. But now philosophy of religion is the thing I love most about it. And it blows me away every discussion that I have. I've sat through the same courses countless times. I remember going back, well, you mentioned in the introduction, I went back to Liverpool as a master's student.
Right.
And I'd just sit back in all the old classes just to relive them over and over again. I've got I think Nietzsche quote somewhere I jotted down because I keep mentioning this point. I keep forgetting the quote. So just quoting from Friedrich Nietzsche, who's a 20th century philosopher. Quoted from his book, The Gay Science, where he asks us, what if some day or night a demon were to steal after you into the loneliest loneliness and say to you, this life as you now live it and have lived it, you will have to live once more and innumerable times more. Would you not throw yourself down and gnash your teeth and curse the demon who spoke thus? Or have you once experienced a tremendous moment when you have answered him, you are a god, never have I heard anything more divine? Hmm. So Nietzsche here is saying to us, imagine
recurrence.
Huh? Good. Yeah, it's constantly on a loop, constantly reliving your life. I found just in a year of master's and being a philosophy student as an undergrad, I would live my life infinitely in this eternal recurrence, just to live those courses again. And it sounds, I never thought I'd say this to my 15-year-old self. And I guess when I speak to people from my high school, they don't really recognize me as the same person. But again, metaphysically, this is, well,
maybe you're not the same person, right?
Exactly. Yeah. So I don't think I am. So yeah, I'm not. You're very different to how you are. I just say I'm not the same person. Then they realize I've done too much philosophy and I'm going crazy. So let's fast forward and speed this up. I left as an undergraduate. I traveled for a year in that classic gap year fashion, wrestling with ideas and existentialism along my way, reading classic books like Zen and the Art of the Motorcycle Maintenance, which is a very cliche book to read while on your travels.
And there's a reason, came back. It's so good.
It is very good, but we won't go into it. I would give a book analysis, but that's a rabbit hole, a can of worms for another day. I went to the University of Birmingham to read teaching studies, trained to be a teacher, went back to my master's in Liverpool, and that was last year. So now, or that was the year before last, and now I'm teaching at King Edward VI in Birmingham, and I've been running the Panscycast philosophy podcast, as you mentioned, for 2 or 3 years now. So that's where I am, and I guess that's a whistle-stop journey of my life. I guess I'd know thyself.
Yeah, pretty good. Someone who's constantly changing, that's not bad at all.
I don't know who I just spoke about, but it certainly wasn't me. It's alien to me.
So what led to the deciding to do the Panscycast? What kind of was the impetus behind that?
There's so many reasons why we started it, mainly because I just thought that philosophy is, for the same reason, I guess, that you guys started Philosophy Bakes Bread in many ways. All those reasons for why philosophy is important. It keeps us away from the slumber of decided opinions, as John Stuart Mill put it. Ooh. It makes us challenge ideas and think about them rigorously. And that's really, really important. You don't have to have a history degree to understand that the slumber of people thinking they're right is extremely dangerous, and the idea of the herd mentality. But not just these extrinsic goods, i.e. things that are good that come from philosophy. Philosophy is something important itself. And I think that people need to study it for a meaningful existence. You know, that Socrates famously said, the unexamined life's not worth living. And some people say that's quite harsh. I genuinely think it's true. I don't think you can live a meaningful life without thinking about the fact that you have a life and your place in it. So that's why I started. We wanted to inspire people to start thinking, but we also wanted it to be enjoyable. It had to be funny. First of all, it had to make people laugh.
Right.
And I think there's a real gap in philosophy for a bit of comedy and a bit of philosophy at the same time.
I agree completely.
We agree completely. A lot of what's out there doesn't involve a lot of laughing in what's available. And man, I have so much fun with philosophy. I think it's important for people to see that. That said, we have to ask you, in the first segment of every episode, we have to ask the question, Jack, what's philosophy?
I knew you were going to ask me this, so I jotted down some notes. And I find safety in my notes. I know it's cheating.
You brought notes to the test?
I brought notes to the what is philosophy question.
It was a very hard question.
Right. Okay. Off paper. The answer is, the reason I jotted some notes is I don't know. And I think that's the most honest question.
Yes.
It's the second question we ask it's the first question we ask everyone on the Panscycast. And it's amazing what you can see from someone's response to this, as you found out yourself. I guess I jotted down Peter Singer's response, a famous utilitarian. I thought, because we'll be speaking about him later, it was quite useful to quote. So I'll quote it briefly here. He told us, "I think of philosophy as the attempt to think about and answer deep questions that are not amenable to scientific investigation. Questions which are not amenable to gathering facts about the world, to running experiments, and to kinds of things that we think of typically as scientific questions. Now, science has made a great deal of progress, but there are still a number of questions, including metaphysical questions and those about logic and those how we ought to live, that science can't really answer. And these are philosophical questions. Metaphysics, I've mentioned it a few times. Some listeners may be aware, others it's, I guess, things outside of physics, big question things. So metaphysical statements include that person with dreadlocks that everyone met in their college days, who's told them that everything was one and sat there in his dreadlocks on the floor and no one saw him again.
But what happened to that guy? became one with everything.
He pops up in every group of people. He just goes from university to university across the world, making sure everyone knows that everything's one. Maybe that is the truth. But yeah, so I think that's what Peter Singer told us was pretty close to the truth. Or like, it gets close to hitting the peg on the head. But I think you have to remember that philosophy at one time was everything. It's just branched off so far. So you've got in the modern period, in the 16th century, it becoming the natural science. It's 18th century psychology, 19th century sociology. So I really think as philosophy as everything. And it sounds very careful and broad, but then again, so was philosophy. So
as in every study or everything? Like when I go play ping pong, I'm doing philosophy.
Eric, I think it's everything. Every study, if you're reflecting and doing ping pong.
Okay, so yeah. The kind of ping pong.
Yeah.
No, the doing of ping pong. So if I'm playing ping pong, is that philosophy? No, but someone doing ping pong and me observing it, that's a part of philosophy. Because I want to say philosophy is everything, like everything people do, everything people study, every subject, every branch. I think it's the study of everything within the picture of life, of existence, of the universe, and beyond those borders, non-life, non-universe, like think ideas that can't come into being and ideas that aren't in being, to throw some curveballs and random phrases at listeners.
Gotta cover all
but
your
I might
bases.
Be wrong here. I mean,
Anthony, I think that's the most expansive definition we've heard so far.
I'm into it. I'm loving it.
I like it.
I might be wrong. I think going back to Aristotle, who mentioned earlier, I think the best way to know what philosophy is to see it in practice.
Right. And
hopefully we'll be doing
well,
that.
Well, when you're studying everything, you find that a lot of times you're wrong. Right. And so part of studying, the more philosophy you do, the more humble people become, at least in theory, my theory, at least.
That's my hope. I'll call it a hope. Listen, everybody, thank you so much for listening to this first segment of Philosophy Bakes Bread with Jack Symes. This is Eric Weber. My co-host is Anthony Cashio. And we're going to come right back after a short break with Philosophy Bakes Bread.
Welcome back, everyone, to Philosophy Bakes Bread. This is Anthony Cashio and Eric Weber here talking today with Jack Symes, and we're going to talk about evil, suffering, God, and ethics. This is going to be a fun one. We're going to get into some deeper philosophy today, guys. So
just little stuff, right?
Strap in. So in this segment, we're going to talk about what's called the problem of evil. That's a capital P, capital E. Sometimes also known as the problem of suffering among scholars, and it's got some theological and philosophical implications. And in the next segment, we're going to turn to a conversation about how Jack sort of answers the problem of evil. He mentioned Peter Singer in the last segment. He's a utilitarian, so there's a little bit of a spoiler about where this whole conversation is going.
And we're going to make sure we define technical terms like that one, but we'll get to that.
Be patient with us today, but this is a good one. It's worth it.
So do you want me to define some technical terms?
Why don't we jump right into it? And I think you kind of have to define it to answer, right? So, right, we got philosophers and theologians in the Abrahamic tradition, right? The tradition kind of monotheism going all the way back to Abraham, Christianity, Judaism, Islam, usually sort of broadly in that category. Arguably longer have sort of grappled with what's called the problem of evil or the problem of suffering. So do you mind laying out what this problem is? Why is it a dilemma? What is the problem here?
Right. So you're exactly right. We're talking about these Abrahamic religions. Specifically, we're talking about Islam, Christianity, and Judaism. And we're talking about particular belief within those religions, which is sometimes referred to as the God, which is the three O's. So we've got omnipotent, omniscient, and omnibenevolent. Now, in order, that means all powerful, all knowing, and all loving.
The omni God.
The omni God. I like the God.
It sounds
more mysterious. Now, there's this big problem for the theist, which means someone that believes in this God in this context. And that's there's loads of evil in the world. How many Adam Sandler movies do we need to sit through to realize that there's a massive amount of suffering?
Oh, please, no more of them.
No. Well, I'll be fairly unkind to Adam Sandler. He's my example that I've chosen. But in a serious sense, I think you can't get away from the fact that this is hugely sensitive of a topic, not only because religion is a sensitive topic, but also because the suffering that people endure is sensitive. So this whole discussion, in this part and the next part, I want to talk about suffering. I've got a quotation here from Stephen Law, whose argument I'll be taking and adapting. And Stephen Law, philosopher of religion, famous atheist, says, "Each day, millions of animals are forced to tear each other limb from limb in order to survive, and this has been going on for hundreds of millions of years. This might in many ways be a beautiful world, but it is also quite staggeringly a cruel and horrific world for very many of its inhabitants."
Right.
So that's obvious to most reasonable people that animals suffer in the animal world, and it's been happening for hundreds of millions of years. And also, before the age of five, another thing from Stephen Law, he quotes Kenneth Hill, a population expert, "Over the long haul, births and deaths have been in very close balance. So roughly between a third and all half of children would die before their fifth birthday across the 200,000 to 300,000 years that humans have been around for." Now, that's an awful amount of suffering. There's a big problem for the theist.
Mm.
Just to put something in the loader very quickly, which perhaps I should have at the start, I'm not talking about my beliefs here. This is philosophy. You've got to provide arguments for your conclusions. If your arguments aren't good enough, you're not allowed your conclusion.
Right.
And I don't have a horse in this race. I am happy to conclude that there is a God. I'm happy to conclude that there is not a God. I really will follow where the reasoning takes me. So if you disagree with anything I'm saying here, then prove me wrong. I'm happy to say you're right and I'm wrong. I want to reach the truth.
You can find Jack on Twitter.
Fantastic. I'll leave my postal address out of it because, I do want to be proved wrong. I think it's a big challenge for theism. And not only that, but thinking about the problem of evil, that the fact that there is loads of suffering in the world helps a Christian, a Jew, or a Muslim think about their belief,
right,
and what they think about the world, and helps them reflect. So I think it's useful not only as a challenge against theism, but also as a tool for reflecting. I don't want to be proved wrong because I can write something new and this is an extrinsic good of philosophy and make my way, prove the existence of God. That would be something for the CV. Now, yeah, I guess the problem of evil against this good God, let's call belief in this all good, all powerful, all knowing God, the good God hypothesis. So traditionally theists give a series of responses known as theodicies. Now, this is the technical term for responses to the problem of evil. These are what I'll go over quite briefly here. Again, just another side note quickly. We interviewed Galen Strawson, and I highly recommend that episode of our podcast, which I'm sure there's a link or something somewhere.
We'll put it in. Like it.
Yep. Put it in.
I hope so. I hope there's a link somewhere else.
There will
God
be.
Certainly is. Galen Strawson told us that, again, he's big on philosophy of mind. He thinks it's morally shocking to believe there is such a God because of all the suffering around. And he finds the idea of these theodicies as unacceptable. I wouldn't go that far. I wouldn't say that it's morally shocking to believe these things. Bertrand Russell famously said, "Most people would rather die than think." In fact, many do.
Bertrand Russell.
Which is quite a nasty, but he's kind of right. We need more philosophy, with more people thinking about these questions. So this is a nice introduction. This is why I love philosophy of religion, because it allows people to do it.
Now, Jack. Mm. You mentioned theodicy is a way of responding to the problem of evil, but is it correct to say that in particular theodicies are ways of trying to continue to believe in the God that has these properties of being all powerful, all good, and all knowing, right? The theodicy is specifically the defenses of that, right? Does an atheist response, we don't call that a theodicy, right?
No, it's grounded in that, I believe it's grounded in that word theology. This
right,
idea that
right, exactly.
Theos is the God.
And I'll just give two or three responses, and I'll give them briefly. So, okay, I believe in this all good, all powerful, all knowing God, but there's all this evil. So how can I reconcile this? I encourage the listener here to just mull it over themselves for a second. I'm sure they've got a response somewhere. This isn't an unfamiliar argument. Now, the first one I come across is the most popular. You need the black for the white. You need, for real free will, good God had to give us the choice of doing evil. To do good requires an alternative decision. So to really say for an action to be morally praiseworthy, you need the opportunity to do wrong. So I like to use the example of a vending machine for this. Okay. Anthony, have you got a favorite chocolate bar?
I'm a big fan of Snickers. Can I plug them on here, Eric?
Are we allowed to put stickers on this?
If you say stickers, we might have to. I'll have to ask.
Eric, have you got a favorite chocolate bar?
Yes, I'm going to call it Choco Bar.
There is a Choco Bar. That's a real one.
There is a Choco. I just was making something up. No, sure. I'm not sure if I should name it on the air.
Let's call it Sugar Bombs.
There you go.
Let's say you go to a vending machine and Anthony, you're dying for a Snackers bar and
nice.
You type in the number S11 for Snackers and it just drops at you. It doesn't have a choice. It's just a machine. You can't praise it for its actions. But say if the vending machine had free will, it could choose whether to keep it for itself selfishly or give it you after you've made this transaction. Now, it might seem right to pat the vending machine on the side and say, thank you for the Snackers bar. Its actions are morally praiseworthy.
You don't have a choice. The vending machines?
I've been told to stop. People think I'm trying to steal Snackers bars. So that's one response. The other, character building.
Yeah.
So we need, good God wants us, our souls to develop. So we need evils for our souls to develop. So suffering is not truly evil. It's telos, which is Greek for its purpose, aim or end, is to be good, to ensure that our souls are ready for the kingdom of heaven or something like this.
The soul-making theodicy, right?
So the purpose of evil is to enable us to be able to become good. Is that right?
Yeah. So we have to fall off our bike to get better at riding our bike. We have to undergo certain evils so our soul develops. You have to watch a load of Adam Sandler films to feel like, it might feel like it's pointless suffering sitting through all of his films.
Yes.
But they'll be good for you in the long run.
It's the Batman line. Why do we fall, Bruce? So that we can learn to get back up.
Very good. That's excellent. I should have included that one in my role. Now, yeah, so the last one, you need certain evils to have certain goods. So you need someone to be hit by a hurricane so you can give them charitably. You need somebody to fall down so you can help them up. So these goods wouldn't exist if there wasn't evil. You can't have them. So that's why they exist, says the theist. Now, I'm wary of time. So I'm going to fly through this second part here, but hopefully you'll be able to connect the dots and see the problem with these. So traditionally, there have been three good responses to the problem of evil. And the theist says, okay, now I'm reasonable in maintaining my view. And that's important because the theist says, I am reasonable. Yes, they think it's a faith belief, but they certainly see their belief as more reasonable than belief in the tooth fairy or please, if anybody I teach, please, can you bleep? Is that okay?
No, this is okay, but we can do a little beep if you need it.
Wonderful. But I just want to make sure I'm getting presents. I don't want to badmouth with life on that.
He's always listening.
So he is always listening, omnipresent. Here's the second hypothesis. Imagine this God, but he's all powerful and all knowing, but he's not omnibenevolent. He's omnimanevolent. He's all evil.
Oh boy.
I believe in this evil God, okay? And somewhat you might say to me, Eric, what's a difficulty with my view?
What's the difficulty with your view, Jack? Oh, are you okay. Asking me or should I say it?
No, you're fine. Either way, you can ask me or you can take a guess. If I told you I believe in an evil God, what would you say?
Oh, I would say there's all these good things in life in the world. How can that be right?
Wonderful. And there's so many good things, aren't there? I think Studio headphones is probably my asparagus. Aaron Eckhart.
Wait. Asparagus is reason there's good in the world? Hold on a second.
Yeah, I had asparagus for lunch. It was pretty good.
It was pretty good. It was so, imagine all that asparagus, Anthony. There's loads of asparagus in the world.
Oh, goodness.
So I say there's all these goods in the world. Okay, well, there's my problem. But I can just run the same arguments that the theist gave me in response to the problem of evil. So I can run the free will defense. To have real evil choices, I need the choice of doing good as well, or else I can't consider them as morally blameworthy. Uh-huh. So I need a vending machine that doesn't give me Snackers bars. The character destroying. So it's not soul building, it's soul destroying. So why is there so much good in the world? So you lose it. That's why there's so many good films in the world, because an Adam Sandler film might pop up one time when you ordered something else. It's there to destroy you in the end. I really hope Adam Sandler's not listening. And and the last one, likewise. So in my response to the problem of evil on the good God hypothesis, I said that some goods require some lower evils or first order evils, as they might be called, so the goods can exist. but this can be flipped as well. You need people to have lots of money so you can be jealous. You need children and family that you love so they can be taken away. Ooh. And Theus might try and say, yeah, it's a very sensitive topic, isn't it? I mean, but there's, you might also say that there's intrinsic goods, the Theus might say, and that's why it's more reasonable. But the evil god believer might say there's intrinsic bads, and these mean goods and bads which are bad in themselves. So the Theus might say life and free will are good, but the evil god believer might say that death is intrinsically bad. So the challenge which it poses is, and I'm asking, this I guess is my listener question, which we'll get to later, why is the good god hypothesis significantly more reasonable than the evil god hypothesis? Uh-huh. Or else it's unreasonable to hold one over the other. And I think this is the biggest challenge to theism.
Wow.
Very interesting.
So there are a lot of responses to this, and I think they can all be solved. I think if you really think about what an evil god would be like, then a lot of the responses don't work, which we don't have time to go into. But there's just a little story which I think is very good. I presented some of my ideas at this in Liverpool. So I call this the evil god and the philosophy conference story. So I was giving a talk on the problem of evil and the evil god challenge at the Liverpool Graduate Conference. And afterwards, I went for a meal with my good friend Tom and his wife Ruth and all the people who went to the conference. And I'm the worst person to sit next to because I just badgered Ruth about all her beliefs. She's a Christian and Tom's a Christian. So I challenged them all of lunch. I ended up getting fairly drunk and I arrived back in my home at Liverpool about 2 a.m. and my house has been broken into and there's glass everywhere and someone's stolen my laptop. Oh, no. With my paper on it and it hasn't been backed up.
That's awful.
I'm devastated because I've been talking about the evil god challenge all day and then evil god strikes again.
Or the good god is punishing you.
Exactly. This is the point. I think that I went into the university next day and I said to Tom and Ruth, I said, evil god strikes again. Apparently Ruth still says this when something bad happens. And I was speaking to someone I was interviewing recently. I told him the story and he said, oh, but at least you've got something good came out of it. You can tell a good story now. And I think this is a perfect example of how this division is. It depends what colored glasses you're wearing when you approach this argument. What are your pre-theoretical beliefs? What do you want to prove? If you don't want to prove anything, I think you'll conclude that they're both just as reasonable. If you're out to prove something, it's pretty clear to me, you know, which side you'll fall. So I encourage everyone to go out as impartially as they can and try and think about it. Why is a good god significantly more reasonable than the evil god? Someone please tell me so I can write a paper on it or something.
Well, thank you so much, Jack. We're going to come back, everybody, after a short break. You've been listening to Jack Symes of the Panscycast podcast. This is Eric Weber. My co-host is Anthony Cashio. And we're going to come back after a short break with more Philosophy Bakes Bread.
If you're hearing this, that means podcast advertising works. WRFL is now accepting new applications for advertising in a selection of our original podcast series. If you or someone you know owns a business in Central Kentucky and would be interested in advertising on WRFL's original podcasts, please email development@wrfl.fm.
Welcome back, everyone, to Philosophy Bakes Bread. This is Anthony Cashio and Eric Weber having a just fantastic, insightful, and challenging conversation with Jack Symes today. We're talking about evil, suffering, God, and ethics. In the last segment, Jack sort of laid out the problem of evil. This is sort of generally understood in certain philosophical and theological traditions and different approaches to understanding that, especially what we're calling the evil God challenge. Imagine there's an all evil God, and how would you argue against that God? I really like that. That was good stuff. So in this segment, we're going to sort of look at some of the conclusions of that argument, of that analysis, and see what Jack has to say about dealing with evil in the world and what kind of follows from some of these arguments.
That's right. So Jack, in our email exchanges, you explained that the idea or the ideas at work in the problem of evil make it, in your view, highly unlikely that there's an Abrahamic God, as we understand from the traditions. So what should we think and say about evil in the world then?
Well, first of all, I want to say it's rational to believe in this God. or do I? I want to say that it's unreasonable to favor a good God over an evil God on what we currently know. It's really important in philosophy to not bite off more than you can chew and only conclude what you've got evidence to conclude. Right. So all I want to say is, here's a challenge. And at the moment, if you can't give me a reason why a good God's more reasonable than an evil God, then I don't see why you should believe in one over the other. So that's what I'm saying. I think it's a challenge that might be able to be addressed. I'm hesitant to say it provides a knockdown argument against theism. But at the moment, I think it's unreasonable to favor one over the other on the basis of
So in that sense, if I don't believe in an evil God for certain reasons like these, then I don't have reason to believe in a good God, is essentially your claim.
Yeah. And so what I'm doing now is trying to think of a response to it. And so, well, outside of this discussion, okay, if there isn't a response to this, then how ought we live? And looking at themes of, okay, let's accept the conclusion of the argument as Stephen Law asserts it, whose original argument it's from. There's other people who wrote about it in the past, but he's made it famous.
If we rely upon a theistic, right, if we're going to suspend, right, if there's a good God or a bad God, then we still need a way to think about how we live, right? So how do we go about doing
good.
That?
Yeah, so let's accept the conclusion for the sake of moving forward that I've just drawn, that we can't favor a good God over an evil God at present. So if we can't believe in a good God, how should we live? And let's just move forward and say that we adopt atheism, the belief that there is no God. And so how does the atheist live? Now, I want to talk about ethics in a second, but I thought it's best, because this is, I guess, the journey I went on, that know thyself. I mentioned that this is going to sound really classic gap year now, isn't it? But on my, when I went away for a year, I couldn't stop wrestling with this question. How, I want to mention a famous French Algerian philosopher called Albert Camus, and who you both might know. And in 1942, he published, I believe it's 1942, an essay called The Myth of Sisyphus. And this is essentially a text which tries to wrestle with this problem. In a indifferent universe with no God, what do we do? And Camus starts the essay by saying something like, judging whether life is or is not worth living is the fundamental question in philosophy. All others can wait, he says. So yeah, I think that's a good place to start here if we accept the conclusion of the argument I raised in the evil God challenge. So those who don't know, in this essay, Camus likens the human condition to that of Sisyphus's. And Sisyphus is this character in Greek mythology who the gods punish and make ceaselessly roll a stone up to the top of a mountain, only to see the rock fall back down again on its own weight. And this happens for eternity. And the gods couldn't think of a worse punishment. And Camus likens this to our position, that we're existing in a godless world, which is futile and pointless and what he calls absurd, which is that we want to find meaning in the world, but it evades us. We can't find it. So he's not saying there's no meaning. He's saying that it's no chance saloon that we're going to get meaning. So you can give up on that idea. And he thinks it's a wonderful piece of writing. And I recommend it to everybody. I do return to it every now and then. And it's accessible as well. So it's a good way to start baking some bread on your own without the help of Anthony and Eric. I want to give a couple of quotations. I'm sorry to be so quote heavy, but I think he's a person you should quote.
That sounds fun.
This first quotation is how you first come to recognize this problem. And I think this is a wonderful way of summing it up. And if you're listening to it now, you're inevitably going to hear the problem. And I wonder, as a point of reflection, how many people go through this, because I certainly did when I fell in love with philosophy. So the quotation is as follows. It happens that the stage sets claps, rising, streetcar, 4 hours in the office or factory, meal, streetcar, 4 hours of work, meal, sleep, and Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday according to the same rhythm. This path is easily followed most of the time, but one day the why arises and everything begins in that weariness tinged with amazement. So here he's saying that one day you'll be faced with the absurd, the fact that your life has no meaning or no apparent meaning. And it's an incredible piece of writing, like I say. Later on, he goes on to say, the worm is in man's heart. That is where it must be sought. One must follow and understand this fatal game that leads from lucidity in the face of existence to flight from light. So here's the problem. We've got a godless world, an indifferent world. What should we do? And Camus gives us two first solutions. He says, you can end your own life and and perform suicide. And I mean, he doesn't like this solution. By doing this, it removes one of the two components of that equation I've just said, a person's search for meaning and his inability to find that meaning. So he doesn't say you should end your own life. And he also discusses the idea of philosophical suicide, the idea that you could buy into the fake idea that life does have meaning, and therefore you can kind of live a life pretending you that it does have meaning. But he couldn't think of anything worse. And I love this quotation from him. "For if there is a sin against life, it consists perhaps not so much in despairing of life as in hoping for another life and in alluding to the implacable grandeur of this life." He thinks that you should embrace the absurdity of life. And this is, I very much subscribe to this idea. It's an existential pessimism in a sense. It's saying that you recognize the world is full of suffering, that it's meaningless, and you just live in accordance with that. And this is really powerful. You should rebel. You should embrace your absurd condition, but still work hard and make it your thing. I'll end with this quotation, if that's okay.
Sure.
At the very end of this, when Albert Camus finally, he does say at the start of the essay that it's the most pressing question, then goes on forever on stuff which is irrelevant before he finally gets to the point. So it obviously wasn't that pressing when he was trying to make his word count. He says at the very end, "I leave Sisyphus at the foot of the mountain. One always finds one's burden again. But Sisyphus teaches the higher fidelity that negates the gods and raises rocks. He too concludes that all is well. This universe henceforth without a master seems to him neither sterile nor futile. Each atom of that stone, each mineral flake of that night-filled mountain in itself forms a world. The struggle itself toward the heights is enough to fill a man's heart. One must imagine Sisyphus happy." Now, this very loosely connects to what I was talking about earlier. I guess I just wanted to talk about the problem of suffering and how it's a challenge to theism, one response to it from the atheist. I was going to talk about ethics, which I'll maybe touch on briefly. But we interviewed someone called Yujin Nagasawa on our podcast who spoke about the problem of evil for atheists. And in a sense, that is that you can't think the world is a good place and on the whole good and be happy to be alive and accept what he calls the systemic problem of evil, which is that evolution itself is an evil thing. The mechanics of the world are evil. Well, not evil, but provide a lot of suffering. So what Camus does is he says, yes, the world is suffering. It is pointless. It is meaningless and it is absurd. But I think that's the right response from the atheist. I think that's the correct one based on the evidence and the arguments which are present.
Well, Jack, our next question relates to some of what you said from Camus. And it's about a response to non-believers that some believers give that I've heard before. And that's that if there is no God, nothing in the world matters. How would you respond to that critique?
If there is no God, nothing in the world matters. Yeah. So you might say that you could create meaning for yourself. That's fine. And a lot of existentialists would do that. That's not my response. I think you can find meaning in things, but always recognize that there isn't a meaning with a capital M that you can reach as an atheist. Now, I'm happy to have my mind changed on it as I am with everything else, but I think that the right response is to recognize that life is meaningless. Now, that doesn't mean you can't enjoy things in life. You can enjoy studio headphones and Snackers bars.
But enjoy them both.
And you can enjoy them on the way up the mountain. And by God, we all do enjoy Snackers and studio. But at the same time, what's my response? My honest response from my heart of hearts and my philosophical positions is that, yes, okay, my life is ultimately meaningless. And I'm okay with that. I'm smiling and defying nature. A final quote, William James: "Good humor is a philosophical state of mind. It seems to say to nature that we take her no more seriously than she takes us. I maintain that one should always talk of philosophy with a smile." And I think we should do that with life as well. And just smile and just be grateful.
I love
that you're
William
alive.
James.
Yep. Me too.
But just as a last thing, I very rarely talk about my own philosophical positions. I see myself more as a commentator or something like this in the world of philosophy, interviewing people, trying to make philosophy bake bread. So there are people much more qualified and experienced in giving these arguments. And I don't want to say that I'm right and everyone else is wrong, but I'm happy to be proved wrong on this. And I think it's important we constantly send that message to people when talking philosophy for people who are unfamiliar with the territory?
We're smiling in the face of the guys. We're making meaning where we can and how we can, and in the face of the absurd. I'm a big fan of Camus. I think he's pretty much got a pretty good read on what it's like to wake up in the morning sometimes, just right there. The alarm goes off and that's it. But it's not the case that we can just do it anything we want. We have to treat other people well. And so we have to have certain kind of ethical rules. And, you know, for a lot of people, religion is where they get their ethics. So what do you recommend sort of how we sort of guide ourselves ethically from this standpoint?
Yeah, I'm aware I've got about 30 seconds
maybe a minute.
Maybe a minute. Okay. Very, very quickly. So does that give me an excuse to commit some fallacies for the sake of being concise?
Is that a permission?
Thank you. Okay. Well, first of all, let's jump the is-ought gap, which is probably the biggest problem. So we'll ignore that. We won't even explain what it is. Basically, I think that suffering is bad, and therefore I think we ought to stop it. Nobody question me on that, please. So suffering, I think, is like Jeremy Bentham, who was a famous utilitarian. Now, utilitarians, there's so much language here. So let me put it in laywoman's terms really clearly. I think that suffering is bad and that pleasure is good. I think you should minimize suffering and increase pleasure and happiness. And any action that does that is the right action if the consequences brought about reduce suffering and increase pleasure. So what's that look like in reality? Well, so a non-human animal suffering, I think, is equal to a human suffering. I think they're equal in the capacity to feel pain. Well, certainly some non-human animals, not all non-human animals. And if I punch Eric, I don't see as him being, I guess I should punch Anthony as well.
Or neither, sure, right?
Both. Or, you know, what if you just really enjoy it though?
Well, if someone said to me, you've got to punch Anthony or Eric, I wouldn't. Equally, your pain would be the same. Your pain is no more important than Eric's answer. I'm not too.
No.
I can't be impartial. And so consider everyone involved in your ethical decision making, everything with the capacity of feeling pain. How much pain? How far will it extend? I think you should reduce suffering. We've got this problem of evil, which is dangerous for the theist belief. I think the atheist can reconcile themselves with the problem of evil with their belief system, i.e. they can say there's lots of evil and still live an authentic existence and reconcile themselves with that evil. And finally, I think it's important that the atheist shoulders the responsibility to reduce the amount of suffering in the world. And that means that they need to count for non-human animals as well as humans.
Interesting.
As well.
So if you don't believe in God, nevertheless, you should feel accountable for the suffering in the world and try and diminish it nonetheless. Is that your view? Mm,
it is. You can ask me, why are we out of time? Because we can finish That's absolutely fine.
Well, all right.
He said he was going to jump over. We absolved him.
Well, we're out of time for this segment, but we're going to come back with one more with Jack Symes of the Panscycast podcast. This is Eric Weber. My co-host is Anthony Cashio, and I've been having a terrific time talking with you all on Philosophy Bakes Bread. We'll be right back.
Welcome back, everyone, to Philosophy Bakes Bread. This is Anthony Cashio and Eric Weber, and today we've been having just a super exciting conversation with Jack Symes of the Panscycast philosophy podcast. We've been talking about evil, suffering, God, and ethics. We've been talking about Albert Camus, the myth of Sisyphus, been rolling boulders up mountains and looking for meaning in them. We ended the last segment talking about ethical approaches to life, if you accept some of the conclusions to the problem of evil. In this segment, we're going to end with some big picture questions, maybe bake some bread, do some philosophies, and wrap up with a question for all of you.
Yep.
So, big picture question for you, Jack. Kind of thinking about all this, you brought a William James, and this kind of put it into my into my head. All right. So, you actually in the last segment kind of presented two sort of ways of if we suspend our belief in God. Now, this is a decide one way or the other if there's a God. Camus presents he's an existential philosopher, presents one approach where sort of make meaning. Life is about making meaning in the face of the absurd, right? And on the other side, we have sort of suffering and pleasure, and we do what we can to end suffering, and we create the greatest amount of pleasure, roughly, very roughly. So for a lot of people, the experience of suffering is best met with faith. they cope with it through faith. Mm-hmm. So for them, faith is the answer to the problem of evil. And Kutten, from both Camus' standpoint, saying, well, yes, it's absurd. I recognize that it doesn't make any sense, but I'm still going to choose to believe in God. Or from the other standpoint, saying, well, look, faith on the whole makes me a happier person, brings better pleasure, and makes society work a little bit better. So, you know, maybe faith is a good thing. And so couldn't we, from either standpoint, give an argument for, I guess it's a pragmatic argument for the need for faith?
So, yeah, I agree with most of the things you've just said there, which might sound surprising given what I've said. As long as we add the clause onto the word faith as reasonable faith, I could have faith that you're eating a Snackers bar right now, Anthony. But I need good reason for thinking that. I need to direct my faith right. with something. Blind faith is one thing, but at least a theist, let's say you have faith in God, you haven't just... Well, some people think you've got an inbuilt sense of God. So then if you believe in God, then your faith is reasonable. You might have arguments for the existence of God. So if you accept those arguments, then your faith is reasonable. But if you don't have anything, like imagine a world where you don't have a sense of God, you don't have organized religion, you don't have these arguments at hand, having faith in like the Great Pumpkin, for example, or the Tooth Fairy, if I had faith in the Tooth Fairy, you wouldn't think this was reasonable. So as long as belief in a good God is reasonable, we can say it's okay to have faith in it. But you need to give me a reason why a good God's more reasonable than an evil God. So just because it helps people is your response to that. Now, this is good, but bear in mind that the evil God challenge requires a significant reason for favoring an evil God over a good God. And why is that? Well, very briefly, essentially the scales could be tipped in favor of an evil God through other arguments. So one I like to quote is anti-miracles. So the good God believer says, look at all these miracles which occur at Lourdes and all these other places around the world. And the evil God person can say, well, look at all these people who are stricken by this suffering. These are anti-miracles. And there's lots more anti-miracles, the evil God believer says. I don't think that's a great one. I think the better one to put the weights in favor, to tip the scales in favor of belief in an evil God would be, what would an evil God do? Well, he'd probably reveal himself to lots of different religions around the world and give them contradictory messages and to really hurt them or something like this. It also deceive them and make them think that he's a good God. So there's certain considerations in favor of that. Now, the pragmatic argument. There was a one religion which I know of, which I struggle with Sisyphus earlier. So I'm certainly not going to try and pronounce the name of this religion that survived until the 80s in the Sub-Saharan desert in Africa. And they worship two gods, a good God and an evil God. But the good God was pretty evil as well. Now, this was one of the most egalitarian societies that have existed in that they valued all members of the community and treated them equally. And you can see lots of virtues in their behavior. And I think you can see more virtuous behavior in theirs than certain countries that believe in good gods. Now, not as perfect as some other countries, but certainly you wouldn't say they were morally abhorrent. They defied their evil gods, kind of like I was speaking about Camus. They'd have these fire dances and they'd throw fire up into God. And they wanted to enjoy life and help their absurd neighbors in the face of these evil gods to defy them. So here we have people who believe in evil gods who are living good lives and treating each other with respect and all those virtues we expect of a society that believes in a good God. I know some people who are working on the evil God challenge disagree with me there. Lots of times people like to say things like people that believe in evil spirits, it's detrimental to their health. People who believe in demons who are causing mental health issues, people that are told they're possessed, that's really detrimental pragmatically. But these aren't cases of evil gods. And often the cases are people have mental illnesses before they're told, or they've got mental illnesses as well as believing in these evil spirits. So I don't buy into it philosophically. Again, happy to have my mind changed. But even then, if you say that it's more pragmatically beneficial to believe in a good God over an evil God, it still doesn't tip the balance.
Interesting. So Jack, our episode today was titled in relation to suffering God and you know, basically ethics. And we've sort of let you get away a little bit with not talking too much about the ethics, but I do have to bring us back to that. At the end of the last segment, you know, you explained that a non-believer would be able to talk about meaning in life in one way of approaching things, or at least ethics in life, with respect to concepts that we can witness, like, you know, pleasure or pain. Like, I, you know, when a cinder block falls on Anthony's foot, I see his pain, you know, the tears Ouch. Coming out and everything, right? and I think that's a bad thing, and we should try and diminish the number of cinder blocks which fall on our feet or other kinds of suffering. And at the same time, like, I like to think I'm a decent guy, you know, and there's some people out there who want to do harm to others. And so I bring this up to say, in a sense, you know, for some people anyway, religion is that motivator. It's that reason to why you should care about other people's suffering. Right. That's sort of one of the messages of Jesus. And if we look to the philosophers in Plato's Republic, the great philosopher argues that philosopher kings should convince themselves and others of the lie, he called it at the time, the noble lie. It's a famous one, right? That all people are born of the same earth, so that we'll care about each other. So you know, saying that there's suffering in the world, that there's pain, that there's pleasure, maybe happiness, that doesn't necessarily mean I need to care about someone else's. And so the great philosopher Plato argued that we need to tell ourselves we're born of the same parent, the earth, and you know, we need to convince ourselves of that, even if we don't believe it. He argued in the Republic that we should convince ourselves of this Phoenician tale, he called it, right? The story that we're born of the same source, in order to then care about each other. Do we not, you know, basically, I guess the question is, how or why should we care about other people's suffering if we're non-believers?
Yeah, good. That's a very, very good question. And yeah, it's a difficult one. So the question is, why be good if you don't believe in a God? Am I happy to phrase it like that, Eric?
Because the believer will say there's hellfire and brimstone, right? There's a consequence of not being good. You're going to go to hell, or you won't get presents from Santa.
Well,
he's always watching.
Good. Now, I want to say that the most irrational theists won't say that. I think the believer in God will say it's not about their just desert. They want to say it's building relationship with God, and it's something which isn't egotistic, i.e. selfish. They're not just out for their own salvation. I think you're not going to make it there if you're a Christian only in the name of getting yourself into heaven.
So basically you undermine others' use of that kind of argument. Rather than tell us why we should care about other people's suffering.
Look, if you're acting purely out of selfishness on the Christian belief system, that's not good enough. You need to have the right reasons for acting that way. On most versions
you're right.
Of Christian ethics anyway. And so recent studies in psychology, I'm not going to quote any directly. I'll mention Christian B. Miller, who we interviewed, who spoke about the problem of we're not virtuous people. Well, many of us are mixed characters with some vices and virtues, and we want to be good. And a lot of people don't just act out of egotism, i.e. selfishness. There are instances where people will act through altruistically. They will act for the benefit of others. So people are naturally inclined to act altruistically. And so you don't need to sell anyone the lie. They'll do it anyway. You can encourage it somehow. I won't recommend a lie. I certainly think there's ways to go about it. My question is, I don't think that people are that selfish to think just about themselves. I'm probably wrong on this, and people are thinking I'm very ignorant at this stage. So why would an atheist who doesn't believe in God want to be good? Why not? I mean, it doesn't, I don't buy the question.
This is
really
a difference in points of view where some people think we're all selfish and others say, no, actually we're cooperative beings. So that's one interesting answer. Yeah.
That's a whole other podcast too.
No, this is good. This is good. I think actually your answer is really quite good about this idea of sort of rejecting one of the premises of my question about this notion that we're always selfish. There's this assumption, you know, in the West that people are so selfish, but actually in other cultures, we don't always make that assumption. Right. And I think you're spot on to highlight that difference of point of view.
No, I'm always arguing with colleagues in other departments because a lot of the premises of what they study begin, well, humans are selfish. And so we go on from there. And I'm like, well, hold on. Why are you just making that big assumption? I don't think it necessarily follows at all.
Exactly right.
Okay. Well, that's a doozy of a topic we just stumbled into. I think we're going to have you back for a whole nother episode, Jay.
Yeah, we might.
Selfishness versus altruism. I think there's a whole, that'll be a fun conversation too. Well, we do want to take a time and make sure that we have a second to sort of in with a little bit of bread, a little bit of dessert, and kind of go on our way, hopefully a little bit of happy, maybe not suffer too much. So we do want to ask one of our final questions. Comes from the show, name of the show. So, Jack, would you say that philosophy bakes bread or that it does not, as the saying goes, right? And if it does, why, how? Give example, show your work.
Yeah, in some fields, it obviously does bake bread. Remember, philosophy is, like I said, I think philosophy is everything. So if, like, literally the baking of bread, I think, is a part of philosophy. So philosophy literally does bake bread. If it's just thinking and thinking deeply about things, you can bake bread and do philosophy. I'm talking a lot of rubbish there. What do I think? Philosophy does bake bread. It helps us live ethical, moralized, helps us think about these big questions, alters our belief systems. It literally puts politicians into power. It founds fields like psychology and all the sciences and everything in between. Like, the idea that philosophy doesn't bake bread is completely, it's ridiculous. You haven't thought about it deeply enough. You haven't done enough philosophy if you think philosophy hasn't baked any bread. You can't not walk in. You can't, if you never walked into a bakery and you walked around saying there's no bread, people would say you were mad. And
I like that analogy.
I like that answer too.
Yeah, that's good.
As you know, Jack, we want to make sure people know the serious side of philosophy as well as the lighter side. So we have a bit in this last segment that we call Philosophunnies. Say Philosophunnies.
Philosophunnies.
Say Philosophunnies.
Philosophunnies.
So we'd love to hear if you've got a favorite joke or a funniest fact or story to tell us about philosophy. Jack, have you got a funny joke or a story to tell us?
I do. I love that jingle, by the way. I should say again, the jingles to the show are fantastic. I've been writing jokes for a couple of years. And when you said I needed a joke for the show, I went through all of my notes, which I've probably got about 10 or 20 minutes of jokes. And they are all completely inappropriate.
Well, I do have a beep sound.
All of them with language.
We're ready for you.
Job. So my brother tells jokes occasionally, but he likes to make sure that I don't know it's a joke. So the other day he said to me, I think I'm going to sell the Hoover. I said, why? And he said, it's just gathering dust.
Oh, that's a good one.
That's a good one.
So, and my other friend Ross, and he always says that he'd like to write jokes and he doesn't want to get up and tell them. So he wants me to tell them. So I said, here's your golden opportunity. You can do it now. Going on the radio, you can tell me a joke and I'll tell it. So my friend Ross wrote this joke. He said, why did the medium cross the road?
Why?
To get to the other side.
Oh, God.
Yeah. Oh, God, that's right.
All right. They're all sort of religious-based. No surprise there. How do you make holy water?
How's that?
You boil the hell out of it.
Wow. Oh, that's blasphemy happening. Why? I didn't know this was a blasphemous radio show.
All right. Number two. Why will you never see Satan in an Armani suit? Because the devil wears Prada. There was no cricket on that one.
I'm surprised you didn't.
Hey, what kind of car does Jesus drive?
I don't know. What kind of car does Jesus drive?
A Chrysler.
Oh, that's good. Oh, wow.
All right, last but not least, if Mary had Jesus and Jesus is the Lamb of God, does that mean Mary had a little lamb?
I don't know if you've earned that one.
I don't know if we earned that one. No, I don't know.
All right. Well, last but not least, we do like to take advantage of the fact that we have powerful social media and Twitters and Facebooks that allow for two-way communication, even for programs like radio shows. So we want to invite our listeners to send us their thoughts about big questions that we raise on the show. And I if you've been listening, we have raised all of them today.
That's right. Given that, Jack, we'd love to hear your thoughts about what question we should ask our listeners for a segment that we call You Tell Me. Have you got a question to pose for our listeners?
Yes. Why is a good God significantly more reasonable than an evil God?
Oh, there we go.
There it is.
Excited to hear back from you guys.
That's probably the, I think that's the best argument, the one I thought about the most of all that I've discussed. But yeah, I'm really interested to hear people's thoughts. It's a question that you don't have to be in the game of philosophy to ask and understand. And in fact, some of the best answers have been given are from non-specialists.
If you're not already subscribed to it, run out, grab your device. I don't know. Maybe you don't have to go anywhere. It's right on your phone. And search for the Panscycast podcast and hit subscribe. It's a great program, and we're so grateful to have been joined by Jack Symes.
Yep, absolutely fantastic. All right. So I want to thank everyone for listening to this episode of Philosophy Bakes Bread. I'm Anthony Cashio, and I'm here today with Eric Weber and Jack Symes, and we've been having ourselves an awesome conversation. We hope you listeners will join us again. Consider sending your thoughts about anything you heard today that you'd like to hear about in the future, or about this awesome and very specific question Jack has raised for you. Why is a good God significantly more reasonable than an evil God? I'm going to be thinking about that one tonight.
That's a doozy. Yeah. That's right. So remember, everyone, that you can catch us on Twitter, Facebook, and on our website at philosophybakesbread.com. And there you'll find transcripts for many of our episodes, thanks to Drake Bowling, an undergraduate philosophy student at the University of Kentucky. Thank you, Drake.
Thanks, Drake.
Thanks also to Stephen Barrera, who's a recent graduate from the University of Kentucky, who gave us some help with the preparations for this episode.
Thanks, Stephen.
And one more thing, folks. Thanks, if you want to support the show and to be more involved in the work of the Society of Philosophers in America, Sophia, the easiest thing to do is to go consider joining as a member at philosophersinamerica.com.
And if you're enjoying the show, and we hope you are, maybe take a second to rate and review us on wherever you're finding us today in podcast form, maybe Apple Podcasts or Spotify. I think we're on YouTube now. Good reviews help us reach more people, and the more people we reach, the more bread we can bake. And so that's all part of the fun. I think it's fun. You can, of course, always email us at philosophybakesbread@gmail.com. That's all one word, philosophybakesbread. And you can also call us and leave a short recorded message with a question or comment that we may be able to play on the show at 859-257-1849. Thank you for joining us again, Jack. It's been a real awesome conversation.
Indeed. Thank you.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure speaking to you both. Yeah. Keep baking bread.
Well, we hope our listeners will join us again next time on Philosophy Bakes Bread, food for thought about life and leadership.
If you're enjoying this podcast from WRFL Lexington, you may enjoy our live radio stream at WRFL.fm and, of course, via radio at 88.1 FM in the Central Kentucky area. We have a wide variety of programs you're sure to enjoy. Just go to WRFL.fm/schedule and see what programs appeal most to you. Thanks again for listening to this podcast from WRFL Lexington.